Hello everyone, I'm Jordana Van of Ravenlight Holistic Healing, and welcome to Gorilla as a Totem. Before we get started, it's important to note that there are two species of gorilla, the Western gorilla and the Eastern gorilla, and each of these species has two subspecies. So while there are some noticeable differences between the species, they aren't really significant enough for us to talk about them as unique totems in the same way that a great gray owl has specific totem wisdom that is different from that of a barred owl, for example. This isn't to say there aren't any noteworthy differences at all, only that they're not significant enough to give my usual suggestion about asking yourself whether you resonate with a particular species of gorilla. Where there is a critical difference, however, is in whether you resonate with male gorillas or female gorillas, as each sex has different priorities and plays a different role in its family. So I'm going to begin the video by talking about what it means to have gorilla as a totem in general, so it doesn't matter if you're male or female, and then discuss each sex separately. And by the way, it doesn't matter if you are physically male or physically female or both, nor which gender you personally identify with, if you identify with a particular gender at all. What matters here is what gender of gorilla you identify with. And if gorilla is your totem, it is indeed possible for you to identify with both genders at different times in your life. So whatever you resonate with now is what you're intended to work with now. And that may change as you progress in your life, okay? I've also got to give a huge shout out to my gorilla person husband, Sean, for being my sounding board on this one and for being willing to allow his insecurities to be dredged up and used as examples. Thank you, honey. I'm married to the most awesome man ever, guys. So, and lastly, sorry, as always, I've tried to give you guys a really thorough overview here, but I didn't include everything or we would be here all day. So if you still have questions after watching this video, if you just want a better idea of how gorilla relates to you personally, please visit my website and schedule an animal totem or spirit guide interpretation session with me. I will be delighted to work with you. Okay, so here we go. So gorillas live in troops that consist of 1 to 4 adult males called silverbacks because the hair on their back turns silver with maturity, some juvenile males called blackbacks, several adult females, and the babies and the young. And troops may be as small as a handful of gorillas or as large as 50 or so. The oldest and the strongest adult silverback is usually the dominant, and therefore he's the leader. And he has exclusive breeding rights to all the ladies. But not all gorillas live in troops. Some males choose to live by themselves, or they're not strong enough to take over a troop or create and hold their own. So we're going to talk first about the gorillas that live in troops, and then we'll talk about those solitary males later. So gorillas have a pretty set routine. They eat, then they nap, and then they eat some more, and then they sleep. When they're not eating or sleeping, then they're playing or grooming or traveling to their next eating and nesting site, which is determined by the silverback. These guys could be predators. They're big, they're strong, they have some pretty scary looking teeth, but they're mostly herbivores, plant eaters. So while some, like Western lowland gorillas, do eat termites and ants, they'll smash the nests when they walk by and help themselves, most gorillas eat stems, fruit, bamboo, and they're not really picky. So while a predator really has to work for a living, they have to wait patiently for their prey to appear and then move in this crazy burst of energy, or they have to track their prey and chase it down, or once they've caught it, they have to drag it up a huge tree to keep it safe from other predators, etc., etc. And if they don't do these things, then they don't eat and they die. Gorillas, which aren't predators and have few natural enemies, have a pretty relaxed life. It's like they live in a buffet. They live in the jungle, their food is all around them, they just eat, sleep, play, eat, sleep, play, repeat. So how does this translate to the life of a gorilla person? Well, gorilla people, first off, usually have an incredible ability to stay focused on one task for hours. You think about the gorillas. Eat, 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 eat. But with gorilla people, this period of intense focus has to be followed by a period of resting or not thinking at all, or they fall apart, they get moody, or they'll get ill. Time to zone out and not do anything is really crucial for their mental and physical health. So these aren't the kind of people who can just go, 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 day in and day out and be okay. They really need downtime every single day. To be healthy, These are also the kind of people who are intended to enjoy a life in which things just flow effortlessly to them. Some people really need challenge, guys. They need life to be difficult, or at least to offer opportunities to defeat something or surmount something, or push themselves to the limit, because overcoming these challenges makes them feel alive. But not gorilla people. Now remember, totems don't necessarily represent who we are, but who the universe is helping us become. And gorilla people often need to learn to stop making their lives so hard when they don't have to be. Most gorilla people feel this incredible sense of responsibility for others, whether they're male or female. They feel that they have to do the right thing all the time, or that they're going to let other people down. And yet, in the life of a gorilla, everything that they need is always there, always around them, and it's totally okay to rest and enjoy themselves because they don't have to work for what they want. It's already there. So gorilla people need to learn to recognize when they're making their lives more difficult than they have to be because they don't feel like they deserve to have things come easily to them, or they fear people will judge them if they're not working hard enough. Two, the way in which an animal eats is equitable to the way in which a human being is intended to nourish themselves. So gorillas eat, 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 eat. It's their favorite activity next to napping. Quite the life, right? After they eat, their droppings, their scat, nourishes the forest from which they've been eating. So in fact, the gorilla is a crucial part of the forest ecosystem because the droppings that their body creates from the food that they eat helps the plants and trees regrow. It's a perfect system. So for gorilla people, when you nourish yourself in the way that feels good for you, when you fill yourself up with joy, when you satisfy yourself, you are automatically nourishing the environment around you. Basically, when you're happy, you automatically make other people happy. When you deprive yourself, when you don't nourish yourself spiritually and emotionally in the way that you crave, your environment and the people in it also lose out. So gorilla people often have a really hard time with this. They fear that if they just relax and let go and do what they actually want, that they'll be considered lazy, or they'll end up being judged for not doing the right thing, or other people will feel let down. And so what ends up happening is they can actually become lazy. They are aware that they need to rest and do something that doesn't feel like work, but they're so afraid of being judged that they won't do the things that they actually want to do. They'll pick something that feels acceptable or that numbs rather than satisfies. So, for example, my husband, who I mentioned is a gorilla person, he really struggled with his garden this year. He wanted to work in the garden, but we had talked about moving, and so he was afraid that if he spent the money on the garden and then we moved, it would be a waste of money. Two, he loves working in the garden. This guy's a champion gardener. But there was still a part of himself that believed that he was not allowed to have fun and that he was supposed to always be working instead. So even though working in the garden would have been deeply satisfying, he couldn't let himself do it. So instead, he'd often find himself playing video games beyond the point at which they were fun, or he'd eat just to entertain himself. He really needed to rest and relax, but he was too afraid to let himself do what he really wanted to do. And so he picked something that he felt was acceptable. Yes, it was restful, but it didn't satisfy. And he found himself doing it longer than needed because it really helped him avoid the feeling of discomfort that would arise from thinking about doing what he really wanted. If he'd just let himself do what he wanted in the first place, work in the garden, he would have been much happier. The whole neighborhood would have benefited from the produce. The gains would have been endless. So for gorilla people, it's really important for them to ask themselves if what they are doing is what they really want to do, or if it's the only form of relaxation or fun that they think is appropriate or acceptable. They are intended to be continuously nourishing themselves, continuously doing things that make them happy. So hardship and work aren't really on the menu for these people. This doesn't mean that they don't succeed, only that their path to success looks a little bit different. Now, while it's important for gorilla people to make sure they're doing what they want to do, gorillas who live in troops live extremely ordered lives. And these orders come from the silverback, who makes all the decisions. So in this case, when we're talking about the silverback giving orders, he's representing a higher authority that has our best interests at heart. So essentially, the silverback here is comparable to the divine, that great force that loves us, that wants what is best for us, and will loudly and clearly tell us what to do if we listen to it. So learning to trust our connection to the divine is good wisdom for everyone. But for gorilla people, it's a really key challenge in their lives. So basically, we're asking, how can I let go of the rules that I think I'm supposed to have and surrender to the real authority, the one that knows which rules to follow and obey those rules? How can I let go of the agenda that I thought I was supposed to have and instead listen to my heart? So instead of listening to the way I was raised that tells me I have to have this agenda, how do I listen to this? This has an unbreakable link to the divine 100% of the time. So when I listen to the divine, I feel safe and secure, and I pick routines to follow that are really, really good for me, not ones that I've imposed upon myself because others have said that I should. This is much easier to do if you resonate with male gorilla than female gorilla. Males are already geared towards wanting to be their own authorities in their lives. Females tend to be looking for someone to be the authority in their life. Ladies, this may be hard to hear, but even if you want to find the perfect mate who looks after you and protects you and gives you a sense of order, the best way to find him is still to focus on being your own authority. Listen to this, and it will lead you to someone who really suits you, not someone that looks the way you think a protector should look. Now, the gorilla troop doesn't stay in one place for more than one day, as they instinctively know not to deplete their food source beyond the point where regrowth becomes impossible. But they don't really migrate either. So they're constantly moving, but because they're staying in the same small area, the venue isn't changing all that much. So gorillas don't do huge 1,000-mile migrations. They just thoroughly explore the area in which they live. So these are not the sort of people, when we're talking about gorilla people, who really like a ton of change. These people can be happy in the same career for years, maybe even for an entire lifetime, but that career has to allow them to really explore different things, learn new skills. They have to be able to really get involved in every aspect of this career. These are also the kind of people who can be happy living in the same area for years, just exploring what exists where they are rather than having to travel to other states or countries for adventure. They really enjoy consistency rather than big dramatic changes, and they don't really like feeling like they've given up on something without exploring it to death. So, just a moment, I have a stuck page. So, gorillas, despite their fearsome reputation, they're actually extremely peaceful. Chimpanzees will wander through a troop's current territory, and the gorillas won't bat an eyelash. Several gorilla troops will share the same territory, and there's no fighting over resources. There's no territoriality, no instinct to protect food or space. Females will fight with other females for the attention of the silverback, which is what they really want because he's the one with the most power to protect their young. And males will fight other males for leadership of the family, but peace really is more common than discord. And no one really cares all that much if someone wanders in and grabs a banana or gnaws on a stalk of bamboo. The fruit in the bamboo will regrow. And so on the whole, gorilla people are the kind that really don't want or need drama. They prefer peace to calamity. And if you don't think that some people want calamity, ask yourself why so many of us love watching reality TV shows. Some people really thrive on all that chaos. Gorilla people don't. They would prefer to live lives that are calm and ordered. They don't feel the need to get involved in other people's business or make a big fuss about other people's actions. When they do get riled up, is if you threaten their family. And this includes actual family members, it includes friends and pets. If you threaten the health and welfare of their family members, you will get a response. They'll still give you time to rethink your behavior. Gorillas are not mindlessly violent, and they bluff more than they act. But if you push, they're gonna make good on their threat. So as the old saying goes, you know, they won't start a fight, but they will finish it if absolutely necessary. Now, even though family's important, this is not alone enough to make a gorilla person happy. Gorillas don't actually need to drink water from rivers or lakes most of the time. They get all the moisture they need from the morning dew or from their food. Metaphysically, water is the element that represents emotion, and obtaining sufficient water to satisfy bodily needs through one's food is indicative that emotional health and balance is dependent upon sufficiently nourishing the spirit. So if a gorilla person is doing the thing that he loves, is learning and feels really fulfilled, he or she is going to be on an emotional even keel. They'll feel peaceful, they'll feel happy. If he or she is not nourishing his soul by engaging in appropriate self-care, no external source, family members or otherwise, can make up for that lack. If the gorilla person is not loving themselves enough by meeting their own needs, it doesn't matter how attentive or loving their family is, it will not be enough. And so again, we have this reminder that gorilla people need to consistently ask themselves, am I doing what I'm doing because I want to, or because I think I have to? Is it really satisfying me, or is it just making me feel like I'm doing the right thing to please others? Now, as most of you already know, gorillas are extremely intelligent. They are excellent problem solvers. They're able to use tools. Gorilla people, it should follow, are also extremely intelligent. In fact, my gorilla person husband is born during the week that a lot of astrologers call the week of the genius, and he would be the first one to tell you that's true. I would be the second. The guy taught himself multivariable calculus. These are smart cookies, guys, just absolutely intelligent. They excel at teaching themselves how to do all sorts of things. They're multi-talented. They are unparalleled problem solvers. However, they have to be allowed to work at a problem in their own way and time. Gorillas have very strong chewing muscles because the plants that they eat are so tough and fibrous. And the quality of an animal's teeth and the way at which it breaks down food is literally linked to the way in which we chew stuff over or think things through. So in order to use something for their highest benefit, gorilla people must be given the time to really chew something over, to work the issue. These people do not respond well to being pressured, and they come up with their best answers when they have time to just sit and approach them from a whole host of mental angles. In fact, when gorilla people do make mistakes, it's usually because they allowed themselves to be pushed to come up with an answer when they knew they needed more time, or because they feared that they were being judged for taking too much time and so rushed. So gorilla people, it is really important for you to always take as much time as you need. Your genius is really worth waiting for. Gorillas are also excellent communicators. They use complex vocalizations, facial expressions, physical postures. They can even learn sign language. And so gorilla people are usually excellent communicators as well. Now, when we talk about excellent communicators, we often envision someone who's a really great public speaker, you know, somebody who speaks easily in front of others. But what I'm really talking about here is someone who's able to clearly express what they're thinking and feeling. So I'm going to use my husband again as an example because I really love that he does this. He's totally capable of just explaining to something to me, but where he really shines is as a mimic. He'll take a line from a movie or a show or a song we've both heard or seen, and he'll use it in just the right way at just the right time to say in three words and a facial expression or gesture what otherwise would have taken 5 minutes, and to share a sense of emotion and context in a way that you would not otherwise be able to do without a lot of explanation. So he may not use a lot of words, but the way in which he uses them makes him one of the most effective communicators that I know. So what it takes me 10 minutes and a bazillion words to say, he could have explained in the time it took me to say this sentence. And gorillas are also extremely emotional. They feel every bit as deeply as humans do, and for the same reasons. And they are not shy about expressing these feelings. So gorilla people, too, are usually deeply emotional sorts, and their feelings run really close to the surface. When these people are upset, you'll know. They may not say anything out loud, but gorilla people are what we would call broadcasters. Their emotions are so close to the surface that anyone paying attention is intuitively going to feel that something is off. So a gorilla person who hasn't learned to accept and communicate their emotions may also put a hole or two through your drywall or break something. These feelings are so intense. If they don't have a healthy way to express them, property damage may ensue. On the other hand, when they're happy, it is readily obvious. They will sing, they will dance, they will vibrate with joy. So for gorilla people, the emphasis is not on being less emotional, but in honoring their emotions, accepting that they have them. So this doesn't mean acting on them, but in recognizing that they're there and letting themselves feel them, listen to them. When we give ourselves permission to feel our feelings, we are able to hear what those feelings are trying to tell us about our reality and what's occurring in it, as well as what needs to change in order for us to be happier. People who don't feel that they're allowed to have certain emotions will inevitably blow up. Those feelings still exist even when we deny them. And if we deny them long enough, they are going to explode in some way. So we'll either make ourselves sick or we'll lash out. So those of you gorilla people who notice that you have a temper, it's time to start giving yourself permission to feel upset about those things that are ticking you off and to sit with those feelings as long as necessary to cool off. Once the emotions subside, you'll be able to speak clearly about your needs and will be far more likely to get what you actually want. That whole being a great communicator thing that I just mentioned, as before, this is something that is intended to be developed, but not necessarily something that you come into this life being able to do. So to really communicate your truth, you have to be in touch with what that truth is. And that means learning to honor your emotions rather than squashing them down until you blow up. Lastly, about gorilla in general, both males and females possess a natural instinct to avoid inbreeding. Because of this, both sexes leave their home troop when they reach sexual maturity. So a male will either try to form his own troop or take over another silverback's, and a female will either mate with a single silverback and they form their own troop, or she'll join an existing troop that only has a few members. So gorilla people, if you're wondering why on earth you can't stand the family into which you were born, or why you're okay living so far away from them, or why you love them but you've got this crazy urge to get away from them, that's why. Most gorilla people wind up living separately from their birth families for a good portion of their lives, and this is necessary for their development. If they don't get away from their families, or at least find a way to separate themselves from their family's influence, they're never going to find out who they really are and reach their full potential. So now let's talk about male gorillas only and what it means if you resonate with male gorillas as a totem, then we're going to talk about the ladies. So each gorilla troop is led by the most dominant silverback, who's usually the strongest, the largest, the most experienced, and he is 100% responsible for the group's safety and well-being. He makes all the decisions, where to stop and eat or rest, when to travel, where to spend the night. And not only does he get the largest portion of food, even when food is scarce, but he's the only male that gets to mate with the females. So even if there are other silverbacks in the group, he's the only one with access to the females, and so therefore all the babies born in the troop are his. Two, such is his power and presence that the dominant silverback can usually bring troublesome behavior to a stop just with a look. This is somebody with a lot of authority, guys. So those who resonate with male gorillas as a totem often feel a great deal of pressure to have all the answers, to know exactly what to do all the time. This is because in gorilla land, if you're a male, but you aren't the leader, you miss out on the good food, the best sleeping spots, all the sex. So you're also subordinate to the direction of someone else, meaning you aren't allowed to make your own decisions. There's an unconscious feeling in many male gorilla people that unless you're the best and can prove it, that you're not going to have your needs met, or you'll be subject to someone else's control. And male gorilla people hate the idea that they aren't allowed to be in charge of themselves. So before they've really matured, meaning they've learned the lessons of this totem, they may pretend to have answers that they don't, for example, or take on far more responsibility that they can handle just to prove that they're rock stars and can be trusted with all that responsibility. So since they feel like they're always needing to prove themselves to have what they want, authority feels really tenuous, and they may therefore fear that everyone is doubting them. And if people are doubting them, that means they are at risk of having their autonomy taken away. If you're not the controller, gorilla people think, you are the one being controlled. This can make gorilla people react really terribly to even innocuous, well-meaning suggestions. When you're in a relationship with an immature male gorilla person, someone who hasn't learned the lessons of this totem, it can feel like you're always walking on eggshells. No matter what you do, they always assume you're trying to control them. For male gorilla people, one of the goals is to get to the point where you know that no one can control you. And so it's okay for you to listen to other people's suggestions because you don't have to go along with them. If you like the idea, great. If you don't, you can ignore it. Basically, you can be open-minded without compromising yourself. This also means that you don't go out of your way to prove that you know what you're doing. You just start being the best possible version of yourself and let that be enough. And mature male gorilla people do actually tend to be good leaders who enjoy the feeling of everyone looking to them for guidance. This is incredibly satisfying for them, and people tend to naturally look to them to solve their problems. I will never forget, my husband and I were playing a board game with some very close friends like 15 years ago, and it was a question on the game, like something like, to the ladies in the group, if all you ladies were trapped on a deserted island and one of you was about to have a baby, which man in the group would you want on the island with you? And every single one of the girls, without hesitation, picked my husband. Does the guy know anything about birthing babies? Not that I'm aware of. But he's very calm in a crisis, and he just has that particular aura, like if there's a problem, he would know what to do. That being said, not all silverbacks wind up leading a troop, just like not all male gorilla people wind up being leaders. And when this is the case, usually one of three things is happening here. First, there may be an incomplete understanding of what it means to be the leader. So leadership in gorilla land, you know, it's not just about the good food and the great sex, but about making all of the decisions and for making these decisions with the group's well-being in mind. This is a lot of responsibility. Two, the silverback is the one who puts himself between the troop and any danger. So there's also an element of self-sacrifice involved. Yeah, the group meets your needs, but you've got to be willing to give it all for the group. And this can feel really scary. Sometimes male gorilla people find themselves in positions of leadership and suddenly realize this is way more responsibility than they wanted. And rather than feeling as though they are in charge, suddenly it feels like everyone else is in charge. And the gorilla person is always being buffeted by everyone else's needs for his time and attention. When this happens, they tend to withdraw from leadership and often any responsibility at all as fast as possible. So here, the lesson tends to involve boundary setting. You're in charge, and the welfare of the group is in your hands, but you cannot be your best for the group if you're exhausted and overwhelmed, constantly meeting everybody else's needs. So you're going to make the best possible leader, and you're going to be at your best and brightest and strongest if you put your own needs first. Also, you really are in charge here. You have to truly accept that before you begin to live it. This brings me to my second point. When a male gorilla person does not get to be a leader, the idea that no one will let him lead. And I actually run into this a lot. True leadership is not given. It's earned. Or in the case of male gorilla land, it is often seized. True power isn't bestowed because what is bestowed can always be taken away. So you either are powerful or you are not. You're either worthy of being a leader or you are not. So waiting around for people to give you power is not going to work. And continuously trying to prove that you deserve it only shows that you lack confidence. So there's this really great saying, a lion doesn't have to prove that it's a lion. If you want to be a leader, be a leader. Step up, be decisive, be responsible. And rather than continually tell people how awesome you are, just do the right thing. Rather than act aggressively to prove that you're the boss, respond with aggression only when necessary. Those who act aggressively all the time are those who are afraid that they're going to be hurt if they let their guard down. The confident people just know you can't hurt them. So if you're feeling like no one will let you lead, then Gorilla is here to help you learn confidence and faith in your own power so you can be a leader rather than waiting around for others to give you the job. The last reason a male gorilla person may not end up being a leader has to do with the male gorilla person's drive for freedom. If you're genuinely in charge in gorilla land, then nobody else can tell you what to do and you always get your needs met. And male gorilla people want to be the only person in charge of themselves. So male gorillas who are not strong enough to take over a troop, who aren't able to create their own, or perhaps just don't want to deal with the hassle of all that responsibility, will often choose to remain solitary rather than submit to the authority of another silverback. This isn't always the case, but it frequently is. So when my husband and I talked about it, he put it this way. He said, I either want to be completely, utterly in charge, so no one can question me or make me do things I don't want to do, or I want to be totally by myself. I don't want to have to submit to anyone, ever. So even in groups of friends, this is not the kind of person who's just going to go along with the crowd. As my husband says, he would only go along with somebody else's direction in the group if it lined up with what he was already going to do anyway. So another gorilla quality that's readily observable here is stubbornness. These people really, really, really want things their own way. They may not even know exactly what their way is, but they will fight for it. And if they can't get their way, well, they don't need you. Now, as I mentioned, gorillas are largely peaceful. In a stable troop, meaning that the dominant silverback has been around for a while and is still obviously strong enough to hold his own, violent incidents are rare. So when it comes to dealing with humans, gorillas are very shy. But when challenged, either challenged directly or the troop as a whole is facing danger, the male will respond. He'll beat his chest, he'll scream, he'll bare his teeth, he'll break off branches and shake them at you, and he'll charge at you. But this is usually just a warning. It's an attempt to show you how strong he is so that you don't force him to hurt you. In fact, 99% of the charges that male gorillas make at an invader wind up with him charging past and then charging again if you don't get the picture and back off. Male gorilla people are actually very peaceful souls. They don't want to hurt you. They could easily, but they don't want to. So they don't attack without reason. And even when you give them a reason, they will hold back unless absolutely necessary. But if you keep pushing them, then they're going to tear you to pieces. So these people, male gorilla people, can be pushed to violence if you push them far enough. Most of the time, however, it just doesn't get that far because their threat display has been so intimidating. So in gorilla people, what we're looking at are people who can get really, really angry when they feel threatened or insecure. They'll often say things they don't mean just to upset you enough to get you to leave them alone, or they may get very loud and scary. You know how some people, when you push them, they'll go into this quiet little shell and it's like you can keep poking at them and they're just not going to play ball? Male gorilla people will lash out when pushed, and they'll probably scare the hell out of you. The idea is to scare you enough that you stop doing whatever you were doing to make them feel like they were on shaky ground. They don't want to hurt you, but they do want you to quit making them feel uncomfortable. And male gorilla people, as I mentioned before, the idea is to let yourself feel your feelings sufficiently enough so that when someone pokes at one of your insecurities, you can safely let yourself feel those feelings of discomfort and then respond calmly and truthfully rather than a rage that doesn't serve you. That person who's poking at you does not have the power to control you or make you less than you are. So you can tell them what you're really feeling. You can stand up for your real needs. So save your aggressive behavior for those people who are really threatening you rather than taking it out on those who love you and want to help you. Okay, now let's talk about the ladies for a bit. So right off the bat, ladies, I'm sorry, but female gorillas do not get to lead troops. So the priorities are a bit different here if you resonate with female gorillas as opposed to male gorillas. And guys, I'm going to use female pronouns here. So even though a guy could conceivably have female gorilla as a totem, the female pronouns are just to help avoid confusion. So men, I'm talking to you too, but trying to change all the pronouns was literally making me feel like my brain was bleeding out of my ears. So this really is best for all of us. So, for males, we just talked about freedom as a priority, the ability to do what you want, when you want. And there's a drive for leadership in most cases, partially because being the leader means you get all the good stuff, and partially because there's a certain joy taken in leadership. For female gorillas, the priority is not freedom, but family, specifically her children. And we can look at this in two different ways. Metaphysically, offspring can represent actual offspring, real live children that you may birth or people who feel like children to you, or it can represent the products of your creative drive, something birthed on a creative level. So just about everything the female gorilla does is geared towards taking care of her children. She will most often choose her troop based on how many females are already in it, because female dominance is based upon when you arrive. So if you're more dominant, you get to sleep nearer and generally be nearer the silverback, who's the primary source of protection for your children. If you argue with other females, it's usually because you're competing with her for the attentions of the silverback. If you have twins, you usually allow one to die, because while this is hard, you cannot feed, transport, and protect more than one baby at a time. By sacrificing one, you're giving at least one of your children a chance to make it to adulthood. And because babies nurse for 3 to 4 years, a huge part of your life and physical resources are going to be wrapped up in taking care of those children. And while female gorillas do engage in social grooming, I'm sure most of you have heard of that, they don't really become close friends with each other. The only relationship into which they make a serious emotional investment is with their children and with the silverback, because he can protect their children. So being a mom comes before all else. So if you resonate with female gorilla, it's very likely that family is a major priority for you. It's unlikely that you will have stayed near your original birth family, but you'll be wholly invested in starting your own and finding a man who feels, or mate, who feels like a protector rather than a soft, sensitive type is probably going to be really important to you. Though again, to find the right protector for you, you have to learn to listen to your inner authority and trust yourself when it tells you someone is right for you and when someone is wrong for you. So don't go after him or her just because they look big and strong. And don't let your emotions carry you away either. Ladies, before you make a long-term commitment to your guy, make sure his words line up with his actions. You know that old saying, actions speak louder than words? If he says he loves you, but he acts in a way that makes you doubt that, he's probably not the one for you. Because her relationship with the silverback is the most critical adult relationship that a female gorilla has, she has to be able to trust that he's going to be there for her. Remember, she's living away from her mother and siblings. She doesn't have any deep relationships with the other females in the group. The guy is a big deal. So, ladies, choose a man that you can really, really rely upon. Like the female gorilla, it's less likely that you have a strong relationship with your folks or siblings. And so this guy has to be able to be both your lover and your best friend and should be worthy of your love. Now, when and if they do have children, these children for the female gorilla person are going to be your whole world for quite some time. Most of your time and resources are going to go to their care, and you are likely to worry quite a bit about their safety. Though while you do love your children, you are able to be pragmatic and make the hard choices when necessary. This may mean denying something to them that they desperately want because you can see that it would place them in danger, or denying one child something that they desire because your other child needs it more and would make better use of it. So, for example, you may not have enough money to send both of your kiddos to college. So you pick the one with the best grades because you know that one's going to succeed in getting their degree. You still love the other child, but their grades aren't as good. So you tell them they're going to have to work a while before going to school. So making sure your children grow up healthy, happy, successful, that's the number one thing in your life. On the other hand, if family is not a priority, then your creative projects are going to be your babies. This would mean that these projects would not only be the central focus of your life, but that each one would take some time to mature and will demand a lot of time and effort before you're ready to release them into the world and move on to a new one. And creativity doesn't always mean art, guys. You know, it doesn't always mean music, writing, acting, you know, our traditional arts. Anytime you're taking your emotional and intellectual and possibly even physical and spiritual resources and channeling them into the creation of something that did not exist before, you're being creative. So with this in mind, writing a song is the same as designing a new piece of furniture, is the same as improvisational dancing, is the same as creating a new filing system at your office. Now, whether we're talking creative projects or biological babies, female gorilla people face one major threat: authority figures who want to destroy their creations. Female gorillas want to stick close to the dominant silverback because he's supposed to protect their children from challenger silverbacks who would kill all the babies in the troop as a way of gaining control. Remember, all the babies belong to the dominant silverback. So when a challenger silverback wants to take over, he kills off all the young a lot of times, and this resets the females to receptive reproductive status. So female gorilla people are often faced with people who will try to tell them what is best for their children or who will demand that the female gorilla people pay them attention at the expense of their children. And again, when we're talking children, we can also be talking creative projects. So, you know, pay attention to me instead of doing all your artwork or, you know, going out and singing or whatever. This could be a new boyfriend, for example, who resents the time you want to spend with your child from a previous marriage. This could be your bossy coworker that tells you that you're raising your child the wrong way. This could be an art critic, you know, telling you that, you know, all this art is a waste of time and you should go back to being an accountant. In either case, you're not intended to listen to these individuals, but to be the parent or the creator that you want to be, to trust and honor yourself and your instincts because they're sound. On the other hand, you know, you could be dealing with people who seem like they have your best interests at heart. Here, honey, you know, let me take care of you. Let me love you. But, you know, put that away. So again, use your inner authority here. Don't let anybody force you to let go of what's meaningful for you, to force you to let go of your creations. In other words, don't let these people kill what matters to you, what makes you feel vital and vibrant and alive. Listening to this is the divine talking. That might be scary, but scary is okay. So again, don't surrender to external pressure or guilt or let somebody telling you you should be afraid block you from doing what you want to do. So I hope this has given you guys a good understanding of gorilla, but if you'd like further information, you are welcome to schedule a session with me. I work with people all over the world. Thank you, Skype. To help them understand the unique messages of their animal totems and spirit guides, and also to help with physical and emotional healing, dream interpretation, figuring out what you're here to do with yourself, and a billion other things. And I'd love to work with you as well. So this is what I do for a living. It's awesome. So if you're interested in working with me, you can visit my website, which is www.ravenlightholistichealing.com. The site will tell you exactly what I do, what to expect, what I charge, how to book a session with me, all that good stuff. I'm also on Facebook and Instagram at Ravenlight Holistic Healing. Make sure you look for my business page and not my personal info, because I do not respond to personal requests on my Facebook page. And while I understand if you would like my professional opinion on your spiritual situation, I do not provide this outside of a formal session. So if you're interested in my opinion or guidance, please book a session with me. Have a gorgeous day, my darlings. Cheers!